If you want the ability to mix any color you see, you need to understand these three things. Just like people, every color has its own unique characteristics and personality, which can be hidden and hard to find at first, but the more attention you give to each color, the more you'll discover about them. So the first thing to note is the hue, or the main category a color fits into. So for example, red, yellow, blue, or purple, it really should be called the hue wheel instead of the color wheel, because really hue refers to those overall broad categories. Black, white, and gray aren't part of the visible spectrum, so they're actually not defined as hues. It should be noted that the word hue, when it's put on the label of a paint tube in the paint color's name, actually has a different definition than how we're using hue here. It essentially means other pigments have been used to mimic an expensive or obsolete pigment, as opposed to the term hue that we're using today, which means the general color category. So even though hue is a pretty simple and quite generic term, it's still important to recognize, because if you can determine the basic hue of a color you see, then you really know where to start when it comes to mixing. So even if you want to get to a darker or a knocked back red, you'll still want to start in a red paint color to help you kick off your color mixing. So the second term to note is value, or the quality of lightness or darkness. That is, black is a dark value or a low value, and white is a light value or a high value. Sometimes people say color gets all the glory, but value does all the work, because often value is the hardest thing to get right in painting and can actually lead to the most dynamic and expressive effects. It can sometimes be tricky to tell the exact value of a color, but to see the correct value of a color, you have to imagine you're looking at a black and white photograph. You can actually practice by looking at black and white photographs and trying to guess the color which you're seeing. Someone wearing a bright yellow t-shirt turned into a black and white picture, it's going to appear much lighter and brighter than somebody wearing a dark blue or purple shirt. A color like yellow, even in its purest form, is going to be much brighter and higher value than a color like purple. You have to return the color in your mind back to that black and white picture, and how much light is it absorbing or reflecting. It would be easier if all pure and straight out of the tube hues were an equal value, but they're not all the same. Pure yellow has the highest value, and violet or blue tend to have the lowest. Understanding value, especially when you're painting in color, can be really difficult, and that's why sometimes you get almost a step back in skill level when someone switches from a grisaille painting into a full color painting. So the last and third thing to think about is chroma. So chroma expresses a color's intensity. High chroma colors are purely pigmented and intense, while low chroma colors are neutral and dull. Words like clear, brilliant, saturated, or vivid describe hues that are pure or close to pure in chroma. Words like toned down, soft, muted, or subtle explain low chroma colors. Most colors that we see are toned down to some extent. As a stylistic choice, some artists choose to use a highly saturated color palette, but it's still useful to have the color mixing skills to capture those more naturalistic, toned down colors that you see in real life. Often, as artists develop their skills, you'll see them use a lot more gray and brown in their color mixing just to knock back some of those pure and vivid colors. Mixing a pure hue with black, white, or gray, or any other color is going to reduce its purity and chroma. So the colors you use are always going to be at their highest chroma straight out of the tube. Although some, especially darker paint colors, won't reveal the character of their color unless you add a little bit of white, even though this does technically reduce the chroma. So whether you add white to lighten the value of your hue, or black to shade or darken the value, no matter which direction, lighter or darker value you take your color in, it will decrease the chroma as well. So even when you add white and you tint a color, it might appear like you're making the color brighter and lighter, but in actual fact, the purity and the chroma and the saturation is actually decreasing. Another great way to decrease a color's chroma is to add in some of its complementary color. However much of the complementary color you mix in will cancel out or neutralize equal parts of that first mix, so it's a great tool to decrease chroma. And this is a way that artists can mix some of those really important muted tones like olives and browns. A fantastic way to decrease chroma without actually changing the value of a color is to mix in a gray of the exact same value of a color. The gray will knock back some of that saturation, but since it's already the same value, it won't actually move the color one way or another. This is why a lot of artists will pre-mix a bunch of levels of gray on their palette. That way, instead of having to mix the exact right gray for each time you want to knock back a color, you already have a whole bunch of levels laid out and you can much quicker get to the exact right value. You'll never be able to increase the chroma of a paint color from how it comes out of the tube by mixing it with other colors, but there are ways in your painting that you can play around with increasing chroma. So whether that's by painting something nearby in its complementary color that will punch up the color, or using techniques like glazing or scumbling or any sort of visual optical mixing. So even though you won't be able to mix a bolder color, you can level up or punch up a color on your canvas by using these tricks. So it can be difficult to wrap your head around at times, but these three components of color, hue, value, and chroma, act kind of independently from each other, sort of like they have their own dimensions. At the same time, adjusting one might change the dynamic of the other two. So in order to mix colors correctly, you sort of have to understand and wrap your mind around how all three elements work. You want to think of these three things like how you might edit a photo, for example. You might adjust the contrast, the saturation, or the value of a photo separately, but yet each time you do, it'll impact on the other adjustments you've made. It's by manipulating and adjusting these three separate elements that you'll get full control over your mixing and you'll be able to mix anything. There are a bunch of charts and color systems that can help visualize as much as possible this dynamic of color, such as the Munsell color system. Also, there are some really fantastic books about color. The most famous of all would be Joseph Albers' Interaction of Color. It's funny because when people talk or describe a color, they often say things like light reddish brown, bright sunny yellow, dark rusty orange, and so many other examples where people naturally, without realizing it, are actually describing the hue, the value, and the chroma of a color. So clearly, inherently, we understand the importance of these three elements. And it's the exact same way when you're mixing. You want to be able to correctly identify these three elements so that in your adjustments, in your mix, you're going to get the whole picture and be able to finely tune and control your mixing so that you can capture the color that you see.